Mic check. Has become my salvation. Hallelujah. The Lord is our salvation. He is our salvation. It's a song that Moses and Miriam sang in their times, in their context, but I'm sure it's a song that we can all sing in our times and in our context, because the Lord is our defense, He's our strength, and He has become our salvation. Hallelujah. So let's rise up. We're going to say a short word of prayer, and then we're going to sing together some songs, and I hope that our posture today is worship, adoration, praise, and surrender, re-surrender. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for today. Thank you for everybody who's been able to be here. I pray that, Lord, you minister to us as we worship you, that you speak to us. For every point of need, Lord, may there be an answer, and an answer that comes from you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Against us, we sing, and if our God, and
God is greater. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than me.
Father, our God is healer. Awesome power, our God.
Our God.
Our God.
Sing, our God is greater. God is greater. Our God is greater. Hallelujah. Welcome to church, to those that are just entering in.
One and all, some to say, for God so loved the world that
the foot of the cross, Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world.
Hallelujah.
Bring all your failures, bring your addictions. Come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world. Praise God. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, for the wonders of His love.
Praise God.
At the cross, where I first saw the light.
This old hymn.
And the burdens of my heart rolled away. Hallelujah. It was there by faith. All my life you have been so good. with every breath that I am made. Oh, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Yeah. I love your voice. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest nights, you are close like no other. I'm not a father.
See ya, yeah. me see under your saving.
One more time. Nukuri, nukuri. Ineza ni mama. Posture of worship, posture of adoration, posture of praise, for you inhabit in that, O Lord. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. As you continue to do good to us, O Lord, we also declare that we shall stay in your house and abide in your house, O Lord. And Lord, this afternoon, also come with a posture of surrender. Surrender to you and your will. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Come on, lift up your voices and just surrender your heart, surrender your voice, surrender yourself to God. Yes. Help you. He's there to walk with you. Come on, just lift up your voice. Surrender everything to God, for His ways are perfect. We surrender, we surrender, oh, we surrender, yeah, oh, like a rushing wind, Jesus, we Lord, have your way.
Lord, as you come and do dwell amongst your people, that you inhabit the praises of your people. Yele, can we worship our God? Can we shout a hallelujah? Because he is worthy of our praise. We worship you, our King and our Lord and our Savior. We bless your name this evening, this afternoon. We bless you, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Amen. Good afternoon, CLA. Now I know it's hot out there, right? I'm also feeling hot. So we're going to do that again, right? Good afternoon, CLA. Much better. It's a pleasure and a privilege to be your host this afternoon. My name is Martha Mwiza Kweli. I am blessed to be here and serving in your midst. I serve with the host ministry, and previous to that I was serving with the youth ministry, and I'm blessed to see a number of familiar faces. I'm glad that you all would come out and, you know, fellowship together, because there is a blessing when Christians and people of God come together. So I want to welcome our friends who are watching us online. You're also welcome. We pray that next time you'll be enabled to be in our midst, because there is a blessing when people of God come together. So I hope you're feeling welcome, although it is hot, hang in there. And I hope your hearts are ready to receive from the Lord today. Let's have the church news.
Hello people, welcome to church today. We're glad that you've chosen to worship God with us, and I hope that you've enjoyed the worship a moment ago. My name is Wicksell Mokalai. I serve here on the pastoral team, and I am glad to present to you our church news. If you are wondering what happens here at CLA, well, every Tuesday we have prayer fellowships from 6 to 8 p.m., On Wednesdays, we gather in our communities called Cell, where we break bread and the Word of God. On Fridays, we have intercession prayers from 6 to 8 p.m. And on Saturdays, we have a fellowship for university students called Campus Fusion from 5:30 to 8 p.m. Prayerless man is a powerless man. And when you do not spend time in prayer, you're giving room for the enemy to do whatever he wants to do. But when you spend time in prayer, you're giving God room to do what he intends to do. Join this community of men every Thursday from 5 to 6 a.m. on our Zoom call as we seek the face of God, intercede for our nation, intercede for our family, and stand in the gap as man of God. See you there. Are you looking forward to dancing, praising God, and having a spontaneous moment of worship? Well, the worship night is happening next Friday on the 26th of May from 7 to 10 p.m. I hope to see you there. I had the privilege of serving one of the most ambient groups here in this church, and that is the teens ministry called True North. And every first Friday of the month, they hold an event called True North Garage, whereby we dance, we sing, we worship, we engage in the Word of God in a fun way. So teens, mark your calendar for June 2nd from 6 to 9 p.m. right here at CLA. Now, I just spoke to you about cells a moment ago. Cells are a place where we grow, where we break bread, and where we disciple one another on our journey of salvation. Now, something interesting is happening on the 3rd of June, and that is cell celebration. So what does it mean? It means that as a cell, as a section, and as a zone, we're gonna come together, we're gonna celebrate what God has been doing, we're gonna have fun, we're gonna have food, we're gonna do a bunch of things together. So you do not wanna miss out on this opportunity. So connect with yourself, connect with your zone, connect with your section, and look forward to the cell celebration happening next month. I hope to see you there. One of my most favorite moments of the year is when we gather together as a church to seek the face of God and bring up our needs and just witness the power of God break through and bring tremendous answers. And I'm sure that many of you have attested to that. So I am glad to announce that we will have a week of prayer and fasting from June 5th to June 9th, and there will be evening rallies happening here from 6 to 8 p.m. So this is something that I pray that you do not miss out on, and I hope to see you there. This goes out to all the married people in CLA. The Family Ministry is organizing a couples getaway from July 1st to July 3rd in Gisenyi. For information on how you can register and book your slot, please visit the information table at the end of this service. So see you, not me, see you there, it's for you. Thank you so much for tuning to our church news. That is what we had for you. I hope that you have a great week ahead and enjoy the rest of the service. Peace out, Pastor Wicksell.
Now we might put anointing, yeah? So thank you so much for the church news. Can we appreciate our AV team and our worship team? They wake up very early, they serve us and they serve the Lord. We love you, we appreciate what you do, and we know your sacrifice, and God is going to honor it, and you know he's honoring it already. So one thing I failed to mention when we started was, I hope that as believers, we appreciate the power that is in fellowshipping together. But beyond that, that we know the privilege we have of being able to meet on a day like this. Do we appreciate this? Do we know that it is an incredible privilege, that many believers do not have this privilege? So I pray that we don't take it for granted and that we appreciate that we are in the presence of our God and we are able to fellowship together. Now, I wanted to iterate a couple of things that were mentioned in the church news, in the event that maybe people missed it or got distracted by a few things here and there. We have the marriage retreat coming up. Anyone here who is married? Come on, guys, be excited. I know maybe just wave and give thanks to the Lord. There are people who are saying, see you, not me, see you there. And for you, you're not... So please endeavor to register at the back. Alpha will be taking your registrations and look forward to seeing you all there. And then we also have our cells. How many of us here belong to a cell? Cells? Yes, I see a bigger number in this one. Thank you, third service people. Yeah? You guys belong to cells, but I also saw hands that were not up. Yeah, and some faces that I can see. Please go register, belong to a cell, belong to a cell family. It is such a blessing. I can attest to it. So I'm praying that all of you who don't have cells will register at the back. There will be somebody there to assist you with that information. And please register. And then there's a celebration coming up that is happening on the 3rd of June. It will be happening in your zones. I hope you're looking forward to it. Amen? Come on, guys. Amen. Thank you. Yeah. I have Pastor Hassan here. He will represent you. He will get the larger portion of the blessings if they're there. And we also have the True North Garage that is coming up. Please do not miss that out. I know that True North team, they meet, back there, but those that have come within the third service, please register and please be there. Such a blessing for our young people to meet together and fellowship. Now, with that said, do we have any first-time visitors joining us today? First-time visitors, raise your hand, wave at me. First-time visitors, oh, there's somebody here. First-time visitors, there's one over there. We love visitors at CLA. You are most welcome. Our ushers are coming to you with a couple of cards. Please write down your name. We'd love to meet with you at the end of the service to get to know you better. Over there is a handsome man who is waving to you, showing you where the hospitality room is. After the service, please join us. And we would love to love on you and get to know you better. If you're visiting for a short while, please... send our love back to your home church. And if you're here for a while, please make that your seat. Amen? Amen? Amen. People, come on. I thought you people have, taken a longer nap. You've rested. Yeah. We're going into a very, very special time, a time to give to our God and a time to also listen to the word of God. Just as, we're giving back to God, we are also getting to receive from him. So can I lead us in a word of prayer? to open our hearts up and ask God that he will come and he will usher in the hearing of his word. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this afternoon. We thank you for your people that have gathered here, Lord, to hear your word, to give to you, King of all glory. We pray, Lord, that you will continue to bless them. We pray for everybody that's giving, Lord, that you will multiply from where they have removed, King of all glory. We pray, Lord, that you continue to expand your word, King of all glory, that it will minister to your people in their unique situations. We pray, Lord, that our hearts will be opened, that we'll not walk away empty-handed, and that your name will be glorified throughout the week and forever. In Jesus' mighty name we've prayed. Amen.
Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. His spirit lives within me, so we shall walk in his peace. That's the song we're going to sing. He is our victory. We praise him. Once you're done, please feel free to sing along, to stand, to rise up. I don't think it's that hard. The Lord is my shepherd.
The Lord is my shepherd.
He goes before me.
He goes before me.
Defender behind me.
Defender behind me.
I won't fear.
I won't fear.
This is our declaration. I'm filled with anointing.
I'm filled with anointing.
My cup's overflowing.
My cup's overflowing.
No weapon can harm me.
No weapon can harm me.
I won't fear.
I won't fear.
Yes, we sing together.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah! I am not alone.
Yeah. He's my comfort.
He's my comfort. Always holds me close.
Come on, let's sing together. He always guides me.
He always guides me
through mountains and valleys,
through mountains and valleys.
His joy is refreshing.
His joy is refreshing.
Yes, he restores my soul. Hallelujah.
He restores my soul.
Sing mercy and goodness.
Mercy and goodness.
Yes, they give me assurance.
They give me assurance
that I'll see his glory.
That I'll see his glory
face to face. Yes.
My feet,
you're my feet. your spirit.
Your spirit will lead within me.
Come on.
So I will walk in your peace. Your spirit will lead.
Yes, whoever believes it, see it.
My victory is
your spirit.
Your spirit leads within.
So I will walk. Yes, your spirit.
Your spirit leads within,
so I will walk.
So I will walk in
your spirit leads.
Leads within
my victory.
You're 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 my victory.
Voices,
hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I am not alone.
Yes, I'm not alone. For he's my comfort.
He's my comfort. Always holds me close.
One more time with our voices we sing. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I am not alone.
Yes, Lord, you're my comfort. He's my comfort.
He's my comfort. Always hold me close.
Hallelujah. We thank you.
A bigger shout of praise. He is our victory, and we are not alone. Amen. 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 Thank you, Joel and team, and everyone serving, the ushers, the people in the sound booth, people on the parking, and everyone. Thank you so much for your service to the house of God. Good afternoon, CLA. I hope you're doing well. Help me greet the person next to you. Give them a high five. And it's good to see each and every one of you. Yeah, so good to see the house full. My name is Wicksell Mukalai. I serve here on the pastoral team as a youth pastor. So we look after teenagers, university students, and young adults. And it is such a joy. Yeah, someone said, who? Yeah, wherever you are. It's good to know that we are serving you. But also, I when I stand here, I also represent the largest community in CLA, and that is the singles, the unmarried. Hallelujah. Yeah, come on, give it out to the singles in the house. Yeah, you have a voice. Yeah, we have a voice. So every time I stand here, I will always echo that. Thank you so much, Pastor Peter
and the entire pastoral team and the elders council for the opportunity to serve God and be of service. Today I am going to talk about something controversial. The topic itself is, for some people, easy, but for other people, it sounds very controversial because it's one of those topics that has created divisions and fights in the body of Christ. And the title of my message today is Saved. Saved. We're going to talk about salvation. Now, the controversy around biblical salvation centers mostly on the different interpretations of the Bible's teachings on how someone can get saved or attain eternal life. Some people believe that salvation is achieved through through faith in Jesus Christ as the Son of God, while others believe that it is good works and the following of religious law that guarantee your salvation. And this debate has led to various denominations and sects within Christianity, each with their own interpretation of what it means to be saved and attain salvation. Some of you grow up and you're told you that if you have dreadlocks, you're not saved. You were told that if you have a tattoo, you're not saved. If you're coming to church wearing shorts, you're not saved. If you're coming to church and you're not wearing a suit, you're not saved. If you're not tithing, you're not saved. If you don't have a nice car, you're not saved. And many people have disagreed on so many things. One of the biggest topics that is up there is, can a believer lose their salvation? Some people say yes, they can. Other people say no, they can't. And it has created a lot of division to the point that churches split over just that question, whether a believer can lose his salvation or not. And this issue remains a topic of theological discussion and disagreement among Christians. But today, I'm not going to dwell so much on speaking into these controversies. But what I'm going to do today is lay a foundation of what biblical salvation actually means. There are people who define salvation as a one-time event when referring to the day when they gave their life to Christ. Others associate salvation with coming to church every Sunday. And some may think that because you are born in a Christian family, that automatically registers you as saved. But salvation is beyond any of that. Now, as we go into our discussion today, I want to lay a foundation by addressing what salvation is and what salvation is not. So there are a couple of statements that will be projected on the screen. So if you have a notebook, if you have a phone, and you're taking notes, there are so many scriptures that I will use today. I will not be able to read all of them, but you can write them down. The first statement goes like this. Salvation is not a formula to be followed and adored, but a person to be followed and adored. Salvation is not an emotion to be felt, but a truth to be embraced. The essence of salvation is not behavioral change, but heart change, which in turn leads to a renewed behavior. Salvation is not a promise of an easier life, but the promise of a fuller one. Salvation is not license to sin. Rather, it is a reorienting of your spiritual taste buds, whereby one tastes sin as bitter and righteousness as sweet. Salvation is not just safety from eternity in hell, but an anticipation to spend eternity with the gracious God who rescued you in the new heaven and earth. Salvation is not the pursuit of God, it is God's pursuit of you. Salvation is not the transaction of our works for God's acceptance, but the gift of His grace for our shortcomings. Salvation is not a ladder to be climbed, but a cross to be borne. Salvation is not a hand raised up, but a life laid down. I like this one. Salvation is not a formula for making bad people good, but it is a power to make dead people alive. And the last one, salvation is not the unlocking of your potential and strength, but it is connecting you to the one who has all potential and strength in your weakness. Come on, you can clap for that. You can clap for that. Yeah. So how does the Bible define salvation? Open your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 to 10. Ephesians chapter 2 from verse 1 to 10. I am reading from the modern English version. It reads, "And you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you formerly walked according to the age of this world and according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. Among them we all also once lived in the lust of our flesh, doing the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and we were by nature children of wrath, even as the rest. But God, being rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. And he raised us up and seated us together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the surpassing riches of his grace in kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, so that no one should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we should walk in them." Salvation carries a big meaning in scriptures. Salvation comes from the Greek word soteria, which means deliverance. Basically, salvation means deliverance from sin and the consequences of sin. And because it is God who is authoring this work of salvation, it is God who rescues you from sin and also the consequences of sin. Now, scriptures point out three important realities that characterize salvation, which I'm about to take you through. Number one, salvation is a gift. Number two, salvation is a choice. And number three, salvation is a journey. Now, let's talk about salvation being a gift. The word gift is an important one in the Bible, and it is good that we understand its definition and implications. In the New Testament alone, there are several Greek words that are translated as gift. But today, I'm going to speak only of two, namely, dorea and charisma. Dorea in Greek means free gift. This word lays a particular stress on the nature of the gift. It is something that is given above and beyond what is expected or deserved. In fact, every New Testament occurrence of this word relates to a spiritual gift from God. That is why Jesus, when he speaks to the woman at the well in John chapter 4, verse 10, he says to her, "If you knew the gift," in other words, Jesus says, "If you knew the dorea, if you knew the free gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you will have asked him and he will have given you living water." The second meaning of gift in scriptures is charisma. That word gave us the word charismatic. And charisma means a gift of grace. Now, this word gift appears when we read Romans chapter 6, verse 23, that says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift, the charisma, the free gift of grace of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." Now, obviously, a gift of grace cannot be earned. Because if you're working for something, then that produces a certain obligation that results in it being a gift of debt. And that is why in scriptures, works don't always support grace. Works all the time destroy grace. Because we live in a generation where you have to work hard or smart to achieve whatever goals that you need to achieve. But when it comes to grace, God says, I have already done the work for you. I have already died for you. I have already paid the price for you. I have already redeemed you. And all that you need to do is receive it by faith. So when presenting salvation, New Testament writers, they carefully chose words that emphasize grace and freedom. And as a result, the Bible could not be more clear in telling us that salvation is absolutely free. It is a true gift of God in Christ, and our only responsibility is to receive this gift by faith. And Ephesians 2:8-9 tells us, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God. That word gift means it is the dorea of God. It is a free gift of God, but at the same time, it is a charisma of God. It is a free gift of grace of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. The second reality about salvation is that salvation is a choice. Tell your neighbor, salvation is a choice. Now, when it comes to choices, it is interesting to note that the older we get, the more independent we become, especially with our choices. And when it comes to salvation, it is no different, because salvation is a personal choice that should not be attached to anyone's taste, preferences, or demands. In other words, no one should be coming to you and tell you, I demand that you get saved. Dear parents, you do not hold your children on the line and you tell them, whoever does not give their life to Christ, I will give him a good spank. It is a choice that they need to make for themselves. As a matter of fact, it is said that two major choices in life characterize the destiny of a human being. The first choice is accepting or rejecting the gift of salvation. And the second choice, and this one I'm speaking on behalf of singles, especially when parents are the ones deciding the people that you should get married to. The second choice should be that you get to choose the person that you want to be with for the rest of your life. But today I'm not talking about marriage. I'm talking about salvation. Yeah? So in Christian theology, biblical salvation is often understood as a personal choice that an individual must make. Because God offers salvation as a gift through faith in Christ Jesus, but it is up to each person to decide whether to accept or reject this gift. And this choice involves acknowledging one's need for salvation, recognizing Jesus Christ as the Son of God, and confessing Him as Lord and Savior. And it is something, and I repeat, it is something that no one should force you to do. Because this choice determines your eternal destiny. Now, how does the Bible make this choice personal? The Bible says in Romans chapter 10 from verse 8 to 10, that the word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. This is the word of faith that we preach. That if you confess with your mouth, not confessing with your parents' mouths, not confessing with your pastor's mouth, but if you confess with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Now, even Jesus made it clear how much of a choice salvation is when he said in Mark 16:16, that whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. Furthermore, he says in Revelation 3:20, that behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone, meaning it's open to anyone, if anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him and he with me. So you are at liberty to live your life however much you want, to make choices however much you want. But you need to also understand that although we are free to choose, we are not free from the consequences of our choices. So this means that if you choose to obey him and walk and live a righteous life, the destination is heaven. And if you do not, on the other hand, and you choose to live a sinful life, your destination is hell. I know that many people don't want to hear the message of hell, but that's what the Bible says. So in fact, the fact that you're choosing not to follow Jesus in itself is a choice. So there is no neutral ground when it comes to salvation. You're either choosing Jesus and that choice is valid, just as if you choose not to follow him, that choice is also valid, but it has consequences. Now, the third thing about salvation is that salvation is a journey. Tell your neighbor, salvation is a journey. Now, to appreciate what salvation is a journey, we need not only to understand what we are saved from, but we also need to understand what we are saved for. So it's not just enough to say, okay, Jesus saved us from sin and the condemnation of sin. That's one thing. But it is also important that Jesus saved you for something. Now, because this is important, because sometimes it feels like being a Christian is all about being saved and helping others get saved. But the deeper we go into him, we discover that being saved means that not only has God saved us from sin, from the power of darkness, not only has he relieved us from that, but he has also saved us for a purpose. And I am here to tell you that God has saved us so that you can carry out the purpose as to why he placed you on earth. And that is to share the good news of his grace and to be the hands and feet of Christ in this world and to show God's love through your actions. I love 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9 to 10. And I believe that you are saved so that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Because once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Now, this journey of salvation is interesting because to understand this journey, we must recognize that salvation is a process by which an unsaved sinner separated from God by sin and his destined to hell has now been redeemed from hell by God. He is now reunited with God and he is destined for heaven. Actually, you were saved for heaven. And this journey of salvation is what we call the phases of salvation. In other words, you have been saved, you are being saved, and you will be saved. These three stages, in other words, you have been saved, that means justification has happened. You are being saved, that means sanctification is happening, and you will be saved, that is the third stage called glorification. All three are critical in your journey of salvation. Now let's start with justification. You have been saved, or we have been saved. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. I know I keep repeating this verse, but it lays what justification says. It says, for by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not of yourself. It is the gift of God, not of works, so that no one should boast. Justification is the act whereby God declares a sinner righteous on the basis of faith. It is not a figment of God's imagination, but rather it is a judicial reality in the courtroom of heaven. In other words, on the day when you give your life to Christ, on the day when you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord, the sinner receives at that point the righteousness of Christ, which is imputed on you. And in the eyes of heaven, this makes that person a sinner legally righteous. That's what justification means. That the moment you come to Christ, God counts you righteous in that it is as though you never sinned before. It is as though you never encountered sin before. And in that moment when we say, I am redeemed, I am loved, I am washed clean, that is a result of justification. And here's the mystery of salvation. Because at this point, you need to understand that Jesus has already taken all the punishment and all the guilt. Therefore, the moment we come and receive him as Lord and Savior, at that moment, we are justified. And Romans 5:1 says, we have peace with God. So every time you come to Christ, God says, this one is as though he never sinned. And this beats the mindset of many, because for many of us, we wait until the person truly changes. But in the eyes of God, God says, well, this one sinned, but since he came to me, I declare him legally righteous. So what does justification refers to? It refers to your position in Christ. When you say, I am redeemed, when you say, I am washed clean, when you say, I am loved of God, that is a result of justification in Christ. Now, it is important to know that in this phase, what is Jesus saving you from? Jesus, in this phase, has saved you from the penalty of sin and the condemnation that comes with it. For the wages of sin is death. But at this point, since you have come to him, God has already saved you from death by giving you eternal life. And what is your responsibility in this phase? It is to receive the gift of God's grace through repentance and acceptance of what Jesus Christ has done. That is justification. And every believer needs to begin with this step. Now that you have been saved, does it mean that you stop sinning? Come on, CLA. Does it mean you stop sinning? Did the devil get kicked out? Is the corruption in the world still prevailing? Yes. So it is not just enough to know that, okay, I came to Jesus, I gave my life to Jesus, now I am justified. But now God begins a new journey, and that is the second stage of salvation, whereby you walk into sanctification. Sanctification, the verse before I tell you the definition, the verse for sanctification, 1 Corinthians 1, 18 to 19 says, for to those who are perishing, the preaching of the cross is foolishness. Even as you give your life to Christ, not everybody believes that you are actually saved. Some people say, so now that you're saved, you're not going to hang out with us? You're not going to do these things with us? What happens? Is that really what your life is going to be all about? The Bible says, but to those who are perishing, the preaching of the cross is foolishness. But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. What is sanctification? It is the process whereby God, the Holy Spirit, transforms the believer into the image and the likeness of Christ. And it is a progressive outworking of the new life that was planted at the moment of regeneration. And this calls for cooperation between the believer and the Holy Spirit. Now, let me make a very bold statement here. There's a difference between being saved and being born again. The Bible says you are saved when you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord. At that point, you're saved. But you are born again when the Holy Spirit now comes and reveals to you the nature of your sin. And in that moment, he cleanses you, he renews you, he removes your heart of stone and gives you a heart of flesh. At that moment, you are born again. I am saying this because to understand sanctification, Jesus spoke to Nicodemus in John chapter 3, and he told him that unless a man is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. To walk in this journey of sanctification, you need to be saved and you need to be born again. So it is not the tryout session. Because if you do not go through the right step, this stage will crush you. Now, this is how Oswald Chambers defines sanctification. He says, sanctification is, he says, the one marvelous secret of a holy life lies not in imitating Jesus, but in letting the perfections of Jesus manifest themselves in my mortal flesh. Sanctification is Christ in you. Sanctification is not drawing from Jesus the power to be holy, but it is drawing from Jesus the holiness that was manifested in him, and now he manifested in me. That's what sanctification means. So what does it refer to? Sanctification refers to your condition of becoming like Christ. I'm sure you're seeing a circle because your journey of salvation comes full circle. We are on the second one, yeah? And in this phase of sanctification, what is Jesus saving you from? Jesus is saving you from the present power of sin. Yes, you got saved, but you will struggle with sin. But Jesus will be saving you daily from the present power of sin. He will be saving you from the works of the flesh. That's what the Bible says, put therefore to death that which is earthly in you and focus your mind on Christ. He will also save you from the works of the devil. Just because you got saved doesn't mean you have escaped from the devil. He will be up there to get you every now and then. And also Jesus will save you from the corruption of this world. That's what sanctification is. So what is your responsibility in this phase? It is to daily die to sin and live to righteousness by applying all diligence in the discipline of all of these three areas: the thoughts of your mind, the lusts of your heart, and the habits of your life. As a believer, until the day you die, you will have an ongoing fight with the thoughts of your mind, the lusts in your heart. And I'm not talking about looking at people lustfully. I'm talking about these desires that will always contradict what the Word of God says. And thirdly, you will struggle with adjusting your habits of life until you die. And on this journey of sanctification, three things are going to be your best friend. Number one, the Word of God. It will be your best weapon of renewing. The Bible says you're not transformed by coming to church. It says, be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, which is by the Word of God. Number two, you will need prayer. A prayerless Christian is a powerless Christian. There's no other way around it. You're going to have to make prayer your friend. And number three, you're going to make cooperating with the indwelling Holy Spirit your priority. Because every now and then, you will have plans, you will have dreams, you will want to do things your own way, and every time the Holy Spirit will be telling you, we are going this other way. Now, the beauty about these three phases of salvation, justification leads to glorification. But glorification leads us to the third stage, and that is glorification. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 to 5 says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an incorruptible and undefiled inheritance that does not fade away, kept in heaven for you, who are protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Glorification is that point in time when the believer's standing and his present state become one, being completely and forever holy on that day in glory. Now, let me break it down what this means. This is what will happen on that day. The Bible says that the archangel of the Lord will sound the trumpet. And at the sound of that trumpet, those who died in Christ, they will rise with him. And those who are alive, we will be caught up with him in the sky. Now, what will happen at that point is that Jesus will give each of his children a body that will defy the laws of physics. Jesus will give you a body that will defy sickness. That body cannot fall sick. That body cannot die. But the beauty is, having received that body, now Jesus will open up the gates of heaven. And when he opens up the gates of heaven, the angels will look at us and they will say, "Who are these people coming?" And Jesus will stand and proclaim and say, "These are my people. I died for them. I rescued them. And now they are coming home." But this is where the most amazing part comes. Because as we enter into the gates of heaven, the Bible said that we will walk on streets of gold. It is okay on this light if you've never walked on a red carpet, but on that day, an entire street of gold is just set for you. And as God's children, you will be walking. And from the front of God, the Bible says, we shall see him. We shall behold him. You will look at Jesus and be like, so that's how Jesus looks. But it doesn't stop there, because Jesus will call each and every one of you by name. Jesus from the front of God will say, "Hassan, come." And Hassan begins walking. And while he walks, the Bible says that Jesus will stand from his front and he will hug his children. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And he will reconnect you with your loved one in heaven. And it doesn't stop there, because Jesus will tell the angels, "Angels, bring all the crowd that I've gathered for my people." And as you stand before him, he puts a crown on your head and he says, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Come and enjoy the glory of your master." At that point is when our salvation is complete. That is glorification. That's the beauty of it. That you were not saved so you can spend the rest of your life telling us, "Well, I got saved." No, you were saved so that you go with God in eternity. Philippians 3:20-21 says, "For our citizenship is where? In heaven. From which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body so that it may be conformed to his glorious body." Can you imagine? "According to the working by which he is able even to subdue all things to himself." Jesus died on the cross to save our souls from eternal death and to grant us eternal life. But here's the good news for every person who is in Christ Jesus, that this same Jesus is coming back to complete your journey of salvation by changing our bodies from this lowly state that it is, and by granting us immortal, glorified bodies that will stand in his presence forever. Actually, let me tell your neighbor, tell the neighbor, until you get on that day, the journey of salvation continues. It continues. Because some of us, we get proud. "Oh, I gave my life to Christ in 1953. Good. I gave my life to Christ in 1992. Congratulations. Some of you, you've been saved for 50 years. Congratulations. But guess what? Until you enter in glory with Jesus Christ, the journey doesn't end. So it doesn't matter how long you have walked this journey. If on that day you happen to be on the list of those he says, "I'm sorry, I never knew you," that is the biggest loss of your life. So you must make it in heaven among those to whom he says, "These are my own." On that day, ladies and gentlemen, you can finally say in heaven and say, "I've arrived." Until then, none of us has arrived. And please do not be deceived by these pastors that are telling you, "I got a selfie from heaven. I took a selfie." No. You will, let me tell you, the promise of God is that you will enter. That is a sure assurance from scriptures that if you walk this journey with Christ, you will enter into the gates of heaven. So until then, run your race. So what does it refer to? Glorification refers to our expectation of being like Christ. In this phase of our life, in sanctification, we are becoming like Christ. But this becoming is not yet fully complete. It will be completed on that day of glory. And in that phase, what will God save us from? The Bible says that He will save us from the presence of sin. And He will save us from the wrath of God coming on those who haven't accepted the salvation of God. To make things even more interesting for us is that not only shall we watch God render judgment, but the Bible says we shall judge alongside Him. We shall stand and judge nations. We will even judge angels. And we will watch God fold the whole world like a paper, and we will watch Him usher in the new world alongside with Him. That means you will forever be saved from the eternal damnation that is to come on this world. So what is your responsibility in this phase? It is to persevere in hope and holiness. That's how we make it to heaven. No working hard for it. No, we just need to persevere in hope and holiness, in anticipation that whether it happens today, whether it happens in 2 hours, whether it happens in 10 hours or in 10 years, but we need to walk in holiness and persevere in hope. As I bring my message to a close, Charles Spurgeon defines salvation this way. He says, "It is not thy hold on Christ that saves thee. It is Christ. It is not your joy in Christ that saves thee. It is Christ. It is not even your faith." Some of us, we bank our salvation on our faith. That is because I believe God so much. No, it is not even your faith in Christ. Although it may be an instrument, but it is the blood of Christ and His merit that saves you. Shall we just close our eyes for a moment? The truth is, so many people have preached many versions of salvation today. People are out there preaching the salvation of blessings. That if you get saved, you'll only get blessings. If you get saved, you'll have good houses, nice cars, you'll have nice jobs. You will always be above. You will always live in abundance. There are so many preachers out there that are coercing people into getting saved. They're telling you, if you don't do this, then you don't deserve salvation. But ladies and gentlemen, I'm standing on this stage to tell you that the one salvation that you need to put your faith on is that of Christ. That if you embrace Jesus in your heart, you are assured of eternal life in Him. And on that day, you will get to stand before God and you will see Him for yourself and He will usher you into glory. So with all heads bowed and all eyes closed, I want to invite you right where you are to reconsider your journey of salvation. Just reconsider and ask God to come into your heart. The Bible says if you confess with your mouth, I cannot confess Jesus for you. I can only speak Jesus over you, but I cannot confess Him for you. I cannot believe Jesus Christ for you. But only you can. It's a decision that you have to make by yourself and for yourself. And to any person here in this auditorium who is listening to the voice of God, let me tell you that this journey, it's not the journey of goodies, things, and happy life, and soft life, easy life. No, it is a journey of highs and lows, but this journey has a happy end. It ends in the glory of God. If there's anybody in this auditorium who would like to give their life to Christ, wherever you are, I want you to shoot up your hand. All across this auditorium, wherever you are, I want you to shoot up your hand. And for those of you that are watching us online, there's a number that is being posted on the screen that you can call in case you want to give your life to Christ. I see a child over there giving their life to Christ. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Now let us repeat this prayer together. Say, dear Lord Jesus, come and heal it. Let's repeat together. Dear Lord Jesus, I confess with my mouth and believe in my heart that you are Lord, that you died for me, and that you raised on the third day. Today, I accept you and I receive you as my Lord and Savior. Come and change me. Come and renew me. Come and make me a new person for the glory and honor of your name. In Jesus' name. Father, I thank you for each and every one of us in this room that has heard your word. Beyond what I can say, beyond what can be taught, I pray, Holy Spirit, that you will teach them, that you will hold them together, that on this journey of salvation, you will hold them close to you. And I'm grateful because I know that you will do so for the glory of your name. Bless your word and bless the ministration of your spirit that is upon your people, even those that are watching online and those that will watch this message later on. May the power of the Holy Spirit lead them to the cross and forever change their lives. I honor you and give you thanks in the precious name of your Son, Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. God bless you.
Wow. Hallelujah. Can we give a round of applause for Jesus? What a word. We have been saved by grace through faith, not by works that none of us would boast. Thank you for that powerful, powerful reminder of what salvation means and what it means to be saved. Thank you, Pastor Wicksell. May God bless you. And I pray that all of us here have taken that reminder, have taken that word, and have kept it in our hearts that it would do the work of sanctification. It would remind us of who we are in Christ and what we've been called to, that we have been created for good works, that we have been predestined for us. Thank you for that incredible message. Now, as we come to the close of our service, I have a couple of reminders, really iterations, but one other one that came to me during the service. A certain Nabutiti Elizabeth Annette lost her passport here in the third service. So if you came across it, it is her passport, her yellow fever card and vaccination card, and her COVID vaccination card. If you did come across it and did not know where to take it, please bring it to the CLA reception and they will, you know, reach out to her and hand it over to her once again. So again, reminders, those that joined us during the service, we have our let offering slots at that exit, my far right, as well as that exit as well. It is such a privilege and an honor to give to the Lord. So for our visitors, please join us in the hospitality lounge after the service. We'd love to love on you, get to know you better, and welcome you to CLA. Reminders are, we have a cell celebration coming up on the 3rd of June. Please show up in your zones and celebrate. We have a worship night on the 26th of May, that is this next Friday. Please don't miss out. It's an incredible time to dance and rejoice and celebrate and worship God. Please don't miss out on that as well. We have a prayer and fasting week coming up on the 5th and to the 9th of June, which will also have rallies after from 6 p.m. every day for that entire duration. Please don't miss out on that as well. And lastly, but definitely not least, is the marriage retreat. Marriage? Anyone? Wow, guys, really? Please do better. So married people, Matt, you tried, but please let's take better energy into the week. The marriage retreat will be happening. You get more information on that, but I believe it is the week of the 1st of July to the 4th, to the 3rd. Yes, fantastic. And we are taking registration at the back. Alpha and Auntie Joanne will be there taking your names down. Please register and fellowship together and learn from one another as married. And now may we rise for the words of the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. Amen. CLA, may the Lord bless you and be with you throughout the week. Amen.
Lord, let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Help us to love and see each other
the way you love and see us. Come on.
My heart is always longed for something more. I search the stars to knock on heaven's door. Creation groans for God to be revealed. Every wound we carry will be healed. My eyes are